India's fourth highest civilian honor, recognizing his accomplishments and contribution to education. So with these words, we welcome Professor Roy. His topic of today is statistics and business analytics. Professor Roy.
Okay, thank you, Maharaj, for the overwhelming introduction. And you can believe that I didn't supply any of the information because of this modern technology. Anybody visits the website and gets all the information. So I think you must have collected from there. Okay, thank you once again. And I've been attached to this university for a long, long time. I've been attached to this Order of Ramakrishna Mission and Math from almost my childhood. I grew up in Narendrapur, and I was, sometimes I make fun about my education associated with Ramakrishna Mission. But the Maharaj has taken a very positive spirit. and this was one of my initial ideas that I was trying to culminate in the country. When I was interacting with the industry pretty much. And few years back, I could realize that this is a subject that is going to be very, very important in years to come. And I remember the first thing that we thought about, that's in 2012 or 13, that then IIM Director Shoibal Chatterjee, he was just appointed the director, and then also Partho P.P. Chakravarti at IIT Kharagpur. And I wanted to treat them some lunch because they had been just appointed in high positions. I was already ISI director. So we three, to be very honest, I first had the same idea with Shobhik, Jadavpur University VC, but which failed because Shobhik left. So my idea was even before that. So I thought Calcutta, ISI and Jadavpur University could do, we have good rapport with Jadavpur University. I was Jadavpur University EC member at that time. And Shobhik being the VC, we did talk but didn't materialize for some reason or other. Shobhik left Jadavpur University. But then when we three met, we thought that this is an area which we are having a vision. It needs expertise from many different quarters. One discipline is not good enough to address the issues here. So we need contribution from statisticians, computer scientists, mathematicians, and also from people from finance and management. Now, how do we get in one institution all this expertise? So we chalked out a program where ISI will contribute statistics, mathematics, little bit of computer science, but IIT Kharagpur will contribute mostly the computer science part. And then IIM Calcutta will contribute the, anyone who doesn't understand Bengali? So you know, namta or multiplication table. We were forced to learn when I was a child, I was forced to learn or memorize namta, right? Duyakke dui, shatakke shadugune choddo, so 7 2 14, 6 3 18, we are forced to learn. Okay, I didn't know what I was learning, some jugglery of words, but that got stored into my brain. At some point in my brain, I got a multiplication table, that namta table stored there. Okay, right? So all of us had. I don't know if you understood what you were doing, but I didn't understand. When I was taught this class 1 or class 2, I didn't understand what I was doing. Just memorize and put it there. Okay? This you will see how they are so related to what we are doing today. No issue to me. What I'll do, it's stored somewhere in some disk or in some device. Okay, some 4 terabyte data. What I'll do, if I'm only trying to do the average, I put a counter here in my RAM. I take, read one number, add it to that. Read another number, add it to that. So it will take a little bit of time, but this is not what I will call, it's really a big data problem. I don't need to do anything beyond that. Just communicating this number from the external device to my RAM and just going adding. But, do you understand what a matrix is? If I am trying to compute an inverse of 100 by 100 matrix, that is a problem. Because they are what we do for solving linear equations with 100 equations, with 100 unknowns. there we do lot of divisions. That the divisions, no matter what program, what computing device you use, are prone to some error. The more and more you do division, okay, the error mounts. And my experience is that beyond 10 by 10 matrices, beyond solution of equation with more than 10 variables, okay, the errors accumulate so much. The traditional method of our Gaussian elimination of the methods, ultimately we get nothing close to even the correct value. So now they have to evolve a method how to solve equations. If I have 1000 equations, 1200 variables, if I am trying to optimize with 4000 constants and 10,000 variables, so it needs special treatment of how to make an algorithm so that I can do it and yet I get a reasonably good solution or inverse. Our usual method that we learned is going to fail. It will not give me the correct matrix. And the culprit is the division. And I have seen in all these big data algorithms, they never use division. They use iteration and convergence to the right solution. You will see later on iterations. Iterations hardly do any division. They will do multiplication, addition, subtraction. And the whole technique of this, when they were doing handling this huge amount of data, they try to avoid divisions. So if you see any iterative algorithm, you would hardly see any division, because people identify that was the culprit, that was my villain in transforming my from a 10 variable problem to a 100 variable problem. So this is what is actually, this transition is what I will call big data. But then since I was trained in ISI from my first year of bachelor's degree, I'll tell a few episodes, stories about what is actually meant by data. Okay, and I'll talk about what is data, and it's very unusual data. So data is, sometimes you get the data, if the government publishes the price index, the inflation, you may publish all your heights. But data is much beyond that. Data is, this is data, of course, but the data that we'll be looking forward is something beyond that. In business domain, they're trying to solve a business problem. Okay? So now, what is relevant data? That is probably one of the most challenges here. If I have to solve this business problem, what is the most relevant data that we need to gather? Okay? The data we get, is it reliable? Is it correct? Can I rely on this data? Okay, I'll tell you through my examples what I mean by this. So business problem and how to get data relevant to the business problem to solve the business problem. So I go back to my BSTAT first year days. We had an outstanding teacher, J. Roy. Outstanding is a very, very small word for him. He's no more, anyway. My teacher in 75, so he's no more. So he told us a story about the father of statistics, Sir Ronald Fisher. He was a very important man. He was a Cambridge professor. So he, we didn't know how to drink tea before British came here, because it's a British custom, this tea. Even if I go to my British people's house these days, they will offer a cup of tea and biscuits. They call cookies, but and even few years before, they would actually drink tea with milk and sugar. We had no option. Normally they would, they may only ask how much sugar you take. But like this black tea, white tea or green tea with sugar, without sugar, with milk, without milk, that was not the British custom. So they used to drink tea with milk and sugar. Now this is more than 100 years back. Sir Fisher was visiting his friend. And the lady of the house, his friend's wife, offered him a cup of tea and some cookies, because they don't say biscuits. We only say biscuits, cookies. And then suddenly it occurred to Sir Fisher that, when you make tea, you boil the water. They brew the tea leaves with this boiled water. And some people put the sugar while brewing, or some people add the sugar after filtering. So there will be a pot, they put some tea leaves, and You have to, and I'm telling this because the most important thing in this subject is to understand the domain. So if you don't understand the domain, you don't know what to do, absolutely. So it's very important to understand the domain, whatever is exactly happening there. So in a teapot, you put some tea leaf, you put boiling water, and then you may add sugar while brewing. Okay, then you allow 5-10 minutes to brew, then you filter, and then normally milk is added after brewing. But in our Punjabi shop, they will boil everything with this milk and etc. Or Punjabi tea. I also like it. It's not that it's bad tasty, but it's a different way of, that's not a British way of making. And the other one could be, you brew it only that with the tea leaves, and then after filtering, you add sugar. Whether this one tastes better or the other one, whether, not this one is better, one, whether she can distinguish between these two processes. She says she can. So Fisher wants to validate or reject her belief. So he has to create some data. So what is data? And this is objective. And then mostly, you know, the business people who are the top bosses there, they will have a lot of ideas, problems, and you say, now we have to solve it for me. So the first job comes, what is the relevant data? You may have plenty of data, but what is relevant for addressing this particular business problem? Now, what could be a data to address this business problem? Whether this lady can distinguish between the two types of teas, type 1, sugar added while brewing, type 2, sugar added after brewing. Okay, does it look like a business problem? No, we are from the industry. Yeah, Arindam and Sumit. So me, Chandan, Aditya, we are all academicians. We don't know what happens there. But I had to learn all these things when I was doing this stuff. So okay, so now this is the best part of the story. So he says, okay, madam, let's play a game. You make two pots of tea. In one pot, you add sugar while brewing. And another pot, you add sugar after brewing. Filter it, put milk there, and get me two pots. So she makes it. So she gets two pots. This is type A, type B. Type A is while brewing, type B is after brewing. And then he says, okay, you give me 10 cups. So she gives 10 cups. Okay, this is all how to generate data. This is very important to how to generate data to solve Shumit's business problem. So this is what is very important, how to generate data. And that I always felt the toughest part in this whole business. For the rest, you have tools these days. But there's no tool for coming to how to generate this data. Okay, then he says, okay, on 5 cups at the bottom, he writes A. Puts 5 cups here. Other 5 cups, he writes B. He puts it here. Okay, and then he says, you pour tea into these 5 cups from your first pot, and you pour tea into this 5 cups from the other pot. She does it. This again, I'm defining the rule of how to come to a business proposition being accepted or rejected. Okay, Sir Fisher is talking about game. Now, even if you have no capability of distinction, how many can you tell correctly? Louder, someone. Five. This is the easiest thing I always say. I'll tell 5 correctly. So even if you have sometimes understand the extreme of this business situation. So if I am not capable of understanding this distinguishing at all, then also I can tell 5 correctly. Okay? And if her claim is right, then she should be able to tell 10 correctly. And he said, you know, because we do statistics, we always allow error. Right away. So there is just no issue at all. So we put negative score in a way that if you don't know anything really, you should get a score 0. Right? So this is these are all in business practice. So now he said, okay, now let's say allow error. So we allow 20% error. Because 5 means you cannot do anything, 10 means all correct. So if you can tell 9 or 10 correctly, I would accept that your concept that you can distinguish between these two varieties of tea is correct. But if it is less than 9, you have to accept that you cannot distinguish. And that I am allowing you 20% errors. The errors will come when you solve a business problem. He is introducing that concept here also. He is allowing you 20% error because 5 is the bottom line, not 0. It's not 10% error. 5 is the bottom line, so it's 20% error. So Sir Fisher is allowing 20% error. So she agreed. So I can. So she sipped all the 10 cups. And the data here is her response. That is the data. It's all, I think all the states do it, but West Bengal does it, I know for sure. Because I know my experience, what is the data, and I know that the data is submitted. Okay? I saw a government vigyapan that due to Kanyashri Prakalpo, the female dropout from the high school has come down to only 2%. All nonsense. I just visited my relative in a village. Half the girls drop out before they finish the school. So whether because of Kanyashri, two of them didn't drop out, I have no data. But this dropout rate is not 2%. So how do I know this data that I'm getting is any correct or not? So I'll tell another story, correctness of data or the, I call data quality. And our teacher, Jera, taught us in a very, very cruel way. Okay, you have to again listen to the prelude. That's the most important. Yeah, so you know, the computers have nothing beyond that. Multiplication means more and more addition. Division means more and more subtraction. So this is addition, this is subtraction. So you have to use this, and the register, you can store things. That's what exactly the Turing machine. So this is a mechanical calculator was actually a Turing machine. Which is basically a computer, but we have to manually all these things. And the classes will be 2 to 5, 3 hours class, and very boring, number one. And number two, it's also very bad because at the end of the class, you know, our shoulders used to pain because do all the time this and that. So that was a nightmare for us, this Jera's practical class. So one day he comes, I think we were in Bister second year that time, he comes. He says, okay, today we have very easy practical. We don't have to get a facet machine from the dean's office. Do you have this practical sheet? These days you don't use it. We had a practical sheet. Physics people will be using it. Some small squares. Square sheets, yeah. 50 rows and 20 columns we used to use. 50 rows, 20 columns. So we have 1,000 small squares. He says, okay, so you take out a coin and toss it 1,000 times. If it is head, you write 1. If it is tail, you put 0. And once you are done, you are done with this today's session. And then he leaves. And we look at each other. You know, we thought Jera is very smart. How can he be such a fool? Does he expect us to really do 1,000 tosses? So he leaves. And we had a very naughty Marathi boy in our class, Chandrasekhar Shivde. He said, no, Jera, I may come back. Let me just try to find out what he's doing. So he followed him. And then he saw that there was a government of West Bengal car, and he got into that car. He says, Jera, gache. Nay. So he's he's coming back. So we're all very smart kids. So we know that out of this 1,000 tosses, head and tail should be evenly distributed, about 500-500. So what you did, when people wrote the exam, there's 100 multiple choice questions. And on the basis of the score, they have selected 600. They will be interviewed, and 200 people will be given permanent railway job. So they did, you know, the machines do this multiple choice question grading, and then they found, they sorted this course, and they found the maximum score was 91, and if you take 600, the minimum score is about 77. So people getting scored between 77 and 91, they are about 600 plus people, and they were to be called for the interview. Okay, so for, and that's what is a railway practice. Now then what, it's Arvind, this chairman of the board, he was going through that, you know, this answer patterns, etc., for the 600. And he had some suspicion. So he gives me a call. He says, Bimal, I doubt there have been extremes of copying. So he has some intuition telling, looking at the answer patterns, that there have been extensive copying. He said, but I don't know why I'm feeling that. Now, do you have any way to make a judgment that whether my idea, my feeling that they have been copying is correct or wrong? Okay, so I told, okay, you can send me the data and let me see. So this is a very confidential data. So he sends an officer with a laptop, and in my design, I told you just put these 600 odd people in a row. Columns are 100 questions. Okay, and you just copy sequence of ABCDs. So that's why I need my data. Otherwise, I can't visualize things. Even visualizing data is very important. So that's one. Okay, so I wanted the data form like that. You have some 600 odd people being selected for interview. So they will come in a row, in each row. I have 100 columns for each question. For every student, every candidate, whatever character they have put against each question, just put the character A, B, C, or D. Okay? And I want to visualize my data like this. This is one important part for the data analysis, to how to visualize the data well. So if you just give me the answer scripts, I may, but my visualization is very difficult. But if I get this data, say 620 people, and then 100 columns, I can have a snapshot look at that. I can visualize this much better. So send me that file. No extra category, just send a flat file. 600 rows, 100 columns. So he sent an officer with a laptop and the data. Okay, then so I was talking to, we have some, yeah, I know. So we have some outstanding students. I'm chatting with one student. Now, how do I know that I'm copying from Shrish Maharaj? How does one know? If we put the same right answer, nobody on earth can find out that we have copied from each other, unless you physically have seen them. From this data, nobody can tell. But if we write a wrong answer, and there are how many ways of having a wrong answer? 3. If we write the same wrong answer, there may be a little doubt that we might have copied. And if I find at least 10 of the wrong answers, we put same 10 questions, we have put wrong answer, and same wrong answer, then I have a reason to believe that they have copied, right? So we did a lot of calculation, but we came out to a threshold like 10, that we found that if two of them have 10 same wrong answer, they mostly copied. So now we have to handle the data. What I do, I take off all the right answers. So I have got 600 rows and only symbols for wrong answers. And then I do a very simple, what I call clustering. Clustering, if I don't know, it would be taught clustering. But I try to, I'm trying to make some baskets. And I put one person in the basket, and another person will put in the same basket if you have the number of common characters is 10 or more. Now we have got two strings. I just see whether I have got 10 or more common characters, then the same, they will be in the same basket. So I create baskets. If I have a basket of cardinality or strength more than 1, what does that mean? They must have copied from each other. A basket of 10, all 10 of them have copied from each other. And I found only less than 100 baskets or clusters of size 1 of these 600 plus, less than 100. 200 jobs are to be offered, and less than 100 from selected one have got are in basket of size 1. We have found baskets of size 37. Whole class. So I told Arvind, they were very serious, and he said, can you defend it in the court if it is got to the court? I said, of course I can defend. The probability computed is so low, by chance it is happening, it's almost like a monkey writing a sonnet. So this thing happening. So he scrapped the entire exam that year. Then my student wrote a small program, very easy program to write these things. A simple clustering program, I defined the similarity measure. So this is, and he found huge clusters amongst all the applicants, all the people who wrote exam. So that was scrapped, and now even today routinely they use our software. So any objective questions you answer, first run this one. And if you belong to a cluster of size more than one, you are not eligible for interview. Okay, thank you.